No pensar, cara. So very good morning, everyone. Myself, Dr. Richa Tomal. I welcome our respected Dean SBSR, Professor H.S. Goan, our eminent speakers of the day, dignitaries, and all the participants on the second day of online EFDP cum workshop on waste to bioenergy, organized by Sharda University, Greater Noida, NCR, and Maharashtra Institute of Technology, Aurangabad, on this platform. We have completed our first day very well, and participation from audience in putting forth the questions is highly appreciable. I hope today also all the participants were involved actively. In the first session, we have three speakers, and each speaker will talk about for 35 minutes, and we'll keep 5 minutes for question answers. So let's begin our session energetically. And I take the privilege to introduce you all with our first speaker of the day, Dr. Sheila Birchmans. Dear participants, Dr. Sheila Birchmans is a retired chief scientist and head electronics and electrocatalysis division, CSIR, Central Electrochemical Research Institute, Tamil Nadu, India. She completed her PhD from Alagappa University, Karaikudi, in 1990. She was awarded with several national and international awards. She has published nearly 106 publications in national and international journals and presented about 50 papers in conferences. She has 2 patents and 2 book chapters to her credit. She has handled several projects sponsored by CSIR, MNRE, DST, and DBT, and guided 10 PhD students. Her research interests include biosensors, microbial fuel cells, electrocatalysis, bio and chemical synthesis of nanomaterials. So with this brief introduction, I request ma'am to take over the platform. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you for the kind introduction. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to share my work on microbial fuel cells. Very good morning to all the participants and the organizers. The topic of my lecture is simultaneous electrical energy generation and biodegradation in microbial fuel cells. This is an interdisciplinary area of science. So I have organized the outline of the lecture as follows, as given in this slide. First of all, I will introduce you to electrochemistry, brief introduction with a few slides, followed by the world energy demand, that is why we are after this development of microbial fuel cells as an alternate source of energy, and the recovery of energy from waste, that is the energy demand of the global energy demand is so huge that we don't want any energy to be left behind even in the waste. Then about microbial fuel cells and the work carried out by us in SECRE in connection with microbial fuel cells and a future outlook of this area of microbial fuel cells. So I told you already, this is an interdisciplinary area of subject. So microbial fuel cells talk about electrochemical energy conversion of chemical energy to electrochemical energy. So when you say electrochemistry, we talk about charge transfer or electron transfer. You may wonder how electrochemistry is connected to biological systems. But if you look at the biological electron transfer reactions and electron transfer reactions at the electrode-electrolyte interface, you can see a lot of similarities. Suppose you see if the charge transfer reactions, they occur under the influence of electrochemical potential gradient. Both are heterogeneous reactions. Biological electron transfer reactions and electron transfer reactions in electrochemistry, both are heterogeneous in nature. both are pH dependent, both type of reactions exchange mass energy across membranes by electrochemical processes under the influence of electrical potential differences. So electrochemistry is broadly defined as a study of charge transfer, which include many different chemical and physical phenomena, which cover areas like battery chemistry, photosynthesis, ion selective electrodes, coulometry, and many biochemical processes. Also, it finds practical applications in analytical measurements. So mainly we talk about the oxidation and corresponding reduction process at the anode and the cathode of the electrolytic cell or the energy conversion device in electrochemistry. If you look into electrochemistry, the electron transfer reactions are basically classified under three categories. One is a substance producer reaction, that is passing electric current between two electrodes, anode and cathode, you can produce substance. For example, if you pass electricity to a copper sulfate solution, you can deposit copper on the cathode, so you can produce a new substance, which is a copper metal. So you can have energy producing electron transfer reaction. Suppose you take the example of a Daniell cell. Suppose you have zinc sulfate on the anode side and copper sulfate on the cathode side. The zinc gets oxidized and it delivers electrons to the outer circuit, giving rise to electrical energy. So similar kind of electron transfer reaction we can see in biological systems. So another type of electron transfer reaction we see in electrochemistry is an electrochemical undevice or a substance destroyer or energy waster, which is nothing but a corrosion reaction. So corrosion reaction does not fall into the scope of this lecture, so I won't talk about it further. So you may wonder how these electron transfer reactions or electric field is associated with biological systems. Suppose you see the nerve cells, there is always a rest potential on the nerve cells of the order of 80 to 100 millivolts caused by the concentration gradient of the K plus and Na plus ions in the inside and the outside of the cells. So whenever some polarization occurs in the nerve membranes, potential dependent permeability of K plus ions occur, which is responsible for the transmission of signals in nerve cells. So signal transmission in nerve cells is nothing but electric field dependent. It depends upon the potential dependent permeability of K plus ion. So it has electrochemical origin. So another example would be the electrical activity of eel fish. Eel fish can be considered as consisting of biological batteries. It consists of electric organs called electrochytes, which are arranged in long stacks in the fish. So it can, just like bats, they use sound for echolocation of prey. These electric fish produce small voltage for navigation. But however, the famous electric eel can even produce 600 volts of electric field. So these examples tell us, so we can, the biological system offer a great scope for the production of electrical energy. And electric field is associated with all the biological systems. Also, if you take the examples of electrical activity of heart, ECG, electrical activity of muscles, EMG, electrical activity of brain, EEG, all are nothing but electric field associated with each organ. Now you have you also talk about electrooculogram, which is electrical activity of eye and so on. So if you see the history of this kind of electrical phenomena in biological system, it all happened as early as the end of the 18th century when Luigi Galvani first observed a twitching of frog legs when subjected to electric field. This can be considered as the beginning of bioelectrochemistry. Those were the founding years of electrochemistry also. So during those years, Volta, he produced the voltaic batteries or voltaic cells. So Galvani and Volta, they used to discuss about this animal electricity together, and they came upon new postulations regarding bioelectrochemistry. During those years only, new power supplies, new batteries were discovered, were invented, and also the problem of transmission of charges or electrons through the solutions were found out, and the Faraday's law, the famous Faraday's law, which is concerned with the transfer of charge through metal solution interface, was also postulated during this period. This was followed by the invention of this microbial fuel cells in 1910, Potter, an electrochemist, he observed a maximum voltage of 0.3 to 0.5 volt in presence of Saccharomyces cerevisiae with platinum as electrode and glucose as a substrate. This was followed in 1930 by Cohen, who produced further bacterial batteries. In 1960s, if you see, in manned space missions, microbial fuel cells were explored for the conversion of bio waste to energy. In late 90s and early 2000s, mediatorless microbial fuel cells were introduced, and in 2000s, microbial fuel cells see a revival of interest. So we now talk about waste to energy, microbial electrolysis cells, microbial desalination cells, photomicrobial fuel cells, sediment MFCs, and so on. Now in the 2000s, we also explore the suitability of these microbial fuel cells as an alternate source of energy. So why should we talk about alternate source of energy? Is it necessary? Definitely, if you see this graph, it shows definitely alternate sources of energy is an essential thing that is to be considered as a primary focus of research by the environmental chemists and others interested in energy. So if you see the world energy demand, when compared to 1980 and 2020, you can see the energy demand has nearly doubled. And if you see the pattern of consumption, it only fossil fuels have been used to a large extent. If you see the contribution of non-fossil fuels, it is very low. The wind, solar, and the nuclear, hydro, and biomass energy contribute to a very low fraction. And compared to nuclear, hydro, and biomass energy, the wind and solar contribute to a very, very low extent. So in order to compensate for the bad effects of fossil fuels, we need to explore more about alternate sources of energy. Also, if you look at the world energy prospects, compared to the year 2008 and 2050, the population will increase by 60%, but however, the energy demand will increase by 63 to 160%. So we have to cater to this kind of population, an energy demand of 63 to 160%. So we need to explore all kinds of possibilities of producing energy. This slide also again shows how much renewable energy is being consumed globally. So the maximum energy consumption is from the non-renewable sources, coal, natural gas, nuclear, and petroleum. Only 6% of energy consumption is from renewable sources, among which 47% contribution is from biomass. The other sources like hydroelectric, geothermal, wind, and solar, they contribute to a small extent. Hydroelectric to an extent of 45%, geothermal to an extent of 5%, wind to an extent of 2%, solar energy to an extent of 1%. So biomass contributes about 47% of the 6% renewable energy that is being consumed globally as on date. If you see our day-to-day activities, we need to consider all possibilities of producing alternate source of energy. So if you observe our day-to-day activities, lot of waste is being produced because of our domestic activities, commercial activities, and industrial activities. If you see the municipal solid waste, 50% of the waste is biogenic compounds like paper, wood, cloth, food scraps, etc. And depending upon the commercial activities and industrial waste, the biological proportion will vary depending upon the industry and the commercial activity. So in initial period, only incinerators were used to convert waste to energy. So incinerators are nothing but the waste is burned to boil water that can run the turbine, which then can which can be used to produce steam and run turbines to produce electricity. That was the olden way of disposing of the waste. Now many new technologies are known today. The other speakers might be dealing with this in greater detail. I will discuss this only in this slide. So there are thermal technologies like gasification. They produce combustible gas, hydrogen, and synthetic fuel. Hydrogen can be used in fuel cells for the generation of electricity. Then thermal depolymerization can produce synthetic crude oil, which can be further refined. Pyrolysis produces combustible tars, bio oils, and chars. Plasma arc gasification or plasma gasification process produce rich syngas, which include CO and H2. Again, this can be used in chemical fuel cells. There are non-thermal technologies like anaerobic digestion. Biogas rich in methane can be produced. Again, this can be used in fuel cells. Fermentation reaction can produce ethanol, lactic acid, and hydrogen. Again, this fermented hydrogen can be used in fuel cells. And mechanical biological treatment can be combined with anaerobic digestion to treat the waste to energy. So the bioelectrochemical conversion, this is the topic which I'm interested in, is nothing but microbial fuel cells, which has been the focus of the researchers for the last two decades for the conversion of waste to energy. So if you see the bioenergy part, there are three ways in which the bioenergy can be utilized to produce energy. The biofuels can be gasified to hydrogen and methane. So hydrogen can be used in fuel cells. So now vehicles, researchers are trying to use it in all type of vehicles. And methane can also be produced as a biofuel, that can be directly converted to ethanol. Other thing is for bioheat application, biofuels are being completely utilized. For example, for small scale heating system, it is used as a firewood in households. In medium scale uses, typically burn wood chips in great boilers. In large scale boilers, they burn a large variety of fuels, including wood waste and refuse derived fuel. So the last one that is being currently being explored for the conversion of biofuels to energy is microbial fuel cell. This is a direct conversion of biomass to electricity by electrochemical means. So why should we go for biofuels instead of the fossil fuel cells? So in this place, in this contest, I would like to quote the words of Michael Jackson, whose song some of you would be familiar of, "Heal the World, Make It a Better Place." So we need to make the world a better place because the faster consumption of energy sources, the mainly fossil fuels, has led to a lot of hazards, or they have modified our earth to a large extent due to pollution, curbing carbon emissions by offering a cheap, so we need to curb carbon emissions by offering a cheap, efficient method of obtaining energy. Also, they lead to a lot of climate changes. You can see global warming is a current topic. Everybody is talking about as a result of this unwanted emissions from the fossil fuels and the related industries. Today, the world is terrified by the other biological weapon, which is coronavirus, which is again is not in our contest. So because of these negative aspects of the fossil fuels, we need to develop or we need to explore alternative source of energy. So fuel cell is considered as one of the alternatives. So fuel cells are electrochemical devices which are environmentally friendly to directly convert chemical energy into electrical energy without intermediate steps. In general, the conventional fuel cells make use of noble metals such as platinum, ruthenium, palladium, and or other alloys as catalyst for the oxidation of pure fuels like hydrogen and methanol at the anode and reduction of oxidant, which is oxygen at the cathode, which work in optimized basic and or acid electrolytes, resulting in a very high efficiency. If you see electrochemical energy conversion, it is not affected by Carnot limitation. So the heat energy which is dissipated is not present here. So we get a better efficiency if the kinetics of the reaction is good. So that is the advantage of electrochemical energy conversion. So in microbial fuel cells, in fuel cells, chemical fuel cells, normally noble metals are used as anodes like platinum, gold, iridium and so on. However, microbial fuel cells, mostly carbon-based materials are used as anodes, where on the anode, the biofilm of microorganism is formed. So here in the anode can consist of organic compounds or wastewater rich in organic compounds. The microorganism can oxidize the organic compounds, and the electrons that are produced are delivered through the circuit to the cathode, where in the catholyte, oxygen is reduced. Also, there are other type of cathode reagents that can be used. Potassium ferricyanide can be an electron acceptor. KMnO4 can be an electron acceptor. Also, we can have microbial species as electron acceptors. Instead of chemical reagent like thiobacillus, ferrooxidants, and so on. So we can have microorganisms in both the anode and the cathode compartment. So we harness the natural metabolism of microbes to produce electric power directly from organic material, making use of cheaper electrodes. So that is the advantage compared to the chemical fuel cells. So you can ask me how the biological system, a microorganism, can transfer electrons to the electrode surface so that it can give rise to electrical current. Three mechanisms have been identified so far to understand how the microorganism respire on the electrode surface or transfer the electrons to the electrode surface. One can be a direct electron transfer. The microbe cell wall may contain redox active components that can directly come into contact with the electrode and transfer the electron to the electrode. The second mechanism is electron shuttling. So by employing a secondary metabolite or an external mediator, the electrons can be shuttled between the microorganism and the electrode surface. So this way, electron transfer communication can take place between a microorganism and an electrode surface. The third mechanism is the microorganisms, they transfer the electrons through conductive appendages. So this kind of nanowires you can see in the biofilm here. So these nanowires can conduct the electrons to the electrode surface. So these three modes have been normally identified as the modes of electron transfer from the microorganism to the electrode surface. And mostly if you look into the literature, mainly two species are being used by the researchers. One is Schwannella, the other one is the iron-breathed Geobacter. Schwannella, if you see, it is a versatile species found almost everywhere on Earth, from mountain, soil, to ocean sediments. They have an ability to metabolize a wide variety of elements that are toxic to humans, yet they don't cause disease in humans. They even have the ability to metabolize radioactive uranium, precipitating it out one of contaminated waste. So it's an ideal bacterium for bioremediation processes. Then the second bacteria that are often being studied is Geobacter, which is called as iron breather, because it has the special ability to inhale iron compounds and use them in a way similar to the way humans use oxygen. In fact, they prefer to live in environments where there is no oxygen, such as deep underground or within ocean sediments. Geobacter species have the ability to consume many environmental pollutants, including petroleum, uranium, and have been used in many soil and soil water bioremediation efforts. So these are the two main species that are being used in the literature. So in SECRE, what we have been doing is our primary aim is to identify microorganisms that are electrochemically active or electrogenic in nature so that they can directly involve in direct electron transfer. So apart from Schwannella and Geobacter, we wanted to identify new species that are electrogenic in nature. So in that connection, also another objective of our work is to fabricate a mediatorless microbial fuel cell. So if you see the history of this microbial fuel cell, in the earlier cases, mediators were used for production of electrical energy, but the mediators can be toxic to the microorganism. So it is not preferable to make use of mediators. So first we tried with the yeast cell, which is Hansenula anomala. It is known to contain the redox enzyme lactate dehydrogenase and ferricyanide reductase. So these two enzymes we could biochemically analyze in the membrane fraction of Hansenula anomala. And mostly what happens in the electron transport chain of this microorganism is that, suppose if you feed these microorganisms with glucose, it is converted into pyruvic acid, then it enters the tricarboxylic acid cycle. And then finally, it is converted into CO2. And during this process, many electrons are produced because this is an oxidation process. So during metabolism, oxidation of this fuel glucose is happening. What is happening in the electron transport chain is these electrons are finally accepted by the terminal electron acceptors, oxygen. So what we do in the microbial fuel cell is we keep the anode in an anaerobic condition. Therefore, oxygen will not be present. Therefore, all the electrons that are produced during the oxidation will be channeled to the electrode surface through these redox enzymes. So we are able to observe direct electron transfer in the case of Hansanula anemola. So that was where we started our work in SECRE. And this Hansanula anemola, next one, we isolated the species, Clostridium species, from sugar industry effluent and used this Clostridium species in two different configurations. One is using carbon felt as the anode, and in one of the configuration, we used electron acceptor ferricyanide in the cathode compartment. In the second configuration, we made use of the thiobacillus ferrooxidans as the cathode biocatalyst. So in the second configuration, on both sides, we had microorganisms. In the first configuration, on the anode side alone, we had microorganisms. And from this, we could produce a power density of around 5 watt per meter cube from the first configuration. And the microbial species on both sides, it gives rise to a power density of 7 watts per meter cube. So the next species which we have made use of is a combination of Gluconobacter and Acetobacter species. Gluconobacter and Acetobacter species, they are found in wineries. These species are responsible for the spoilage of wine in wineries. So that is why we have chosen these two organisms, and mostly Gluconobacter consume the glucose and convert it into acetic acid, and Acetobacter convert acetic acid finally to carbon dioxide. So the combination would work out. That's what is our thinking. Therefore, we used this these two bacteria independently and as a mixture in the microbial fuel cells for the treatment of winery effluents and for bad wine. Suppose due to the proliferation of these two species in the wineries, sometimes the wine becomes bad. So the bad wine can be treated by the microbial fuel cells. So we studied in detail the bioelectrocatalysis of Acetobacter acetate and Gluconobacter roseus for current generation. And this was published in Environmental Science and Technology. And our the news about our paper was cited in many news websites, in ACS news websites and many different news websites. So it was quoted by Eric Bland in 2009 like this: when good grapes make bad wine, the end result could be clean energy. So that was the gist of our work. So we can make clean energy out of bad wine. So this is the news web. These are the different news websites where our paper has been cited. And this was also cited by the ACS journals in the news, and it was quoted in the World News. Indian and American scientists use bad wine to make good energy. So this was a effort made by us to treat winery effluents and bad wines with a combination of two species, Acetobacter and Gluconobacter. So if you see the performance characteristics of our biofuel cells, AB MFC refers to Acetobacter MFC, Acetobacter independently. GB MFC means Gluconobacter independently. AG means Acetobacter plus Gluconobacter. So the maximum power density you can see is 1.488 from the mixed MFC, and the maximum current density is of 4.88 ampere per meter cube from the mixed MFC. If you see the Coulombic efficiency, independently, Acetobacter MFC has given rise to a Coulombic efficiency of 1.72. Gluconobacter has given rise to a Coulombic efficiency of 1.1. And the mixed MFC, Acetobacter and Gluconobacter, has given rise to an efficiency of 4.65%. So these are the different cell configuration that we have been using in our lab for the treatment, for the production of electrical energy. These are two different flow cells. These are batch cell. This is another flow cell. And this is another batch cell. So we also worked with the Clostridium acetobutylicum, where mostly we made use of carbon felt as the electrode. And in the cathode, we made use of potassium ferricyanide mostly. And these are the growth curves for the Clostridium acetobutylicum. And in the Clostridium acetobutylicum, you can see we tested with two different wastewater, biscuit wastewater MFC and potato wastewater MFC. So you can see in the case of biscuit wastewater, around 1 watt can be produced. And here in the potato wastewater, 1.4 watts can be produced as electrical energy. Also, we made use of the yeast species Hansenula anemola for the biodegradation of azo dyes, because Hansenula anemola contains another redox enzyme, azo reductase. So this is a flow cell constructed by us, and the OCV of the cell was 0.35 volt. And from the polarization behavior, you can see it can give rise to a wattage of 1.416 at 11.9 ampere per meter cube when the internal resistance was 357. And in presence of glucose, it gives rise to a power of 3.61 at 38 ampere per meter cube. And if you compare the COD removal of methyl red, within 24 hours, we could see a COD removal of 45.95%. And in the glucose acetate biofuel cell, it is less. It reached 12.72 within 24 hours and 40.9% after 96 hours. And we have shown this, our batch cells could run display devices and clocks. So this is a demonstration from our lab. And another work which we carried out was, we isolated the rumen fluid from goat or cow. And from the rumen fluid, we isolated the pure cultures and isolated species that can degrade cellulose. Because cellulose, most of the biomass, if you analyze, mostly it is cellulosic in origin. So it is better to find out a biocatalyst that can degrade cellulose. So from the rumen fluid, we identified the cellulose degrading bacteria, and we could get very good current density out of this bacteria, which is mostly Enterobacter species, Staphylococcus and E. coli were isolated. And among this, SRS had a very good cellulose degrading ability. And by way of treating lignocellulosic mass, we made another effort where we have treated sugar bagasse or corn cob using cyanobacteria, oscillatoria, and the cyanobacteria that is used, where we have modified the two compartment microbial fuel cell to a three compartment microbial fuel cell. So in the first compartment, the cyanobacteria degrades lignocellulose to glucose. This glucose is fed to the second compartment, which consists of a biofilm of the combination of Acetobacter and Gluconobacter. So Acetobacter, Gluconobacter MFC works well, we have already shown. So we have combined this for the lignocellulose degradation in a three-chamber MFC. Here we have obtained a power output of 8.78 watt per meter cube at 20.95 ampere per meter cube in the case of sugarcane bagasse and 6.73 watt per meter cube in the case of corn cob. And this is the power curve for this. And also we observed this symbiosis of photosynthetic microorganism with the non-photosynthetic ones in the cellulosic mass, where we have made the modified the anode. Because in the earlier case, we made use of simple carbon felt anode. So we tried to improve the power density. So we modified the carbon felt with chitosan and sodium alginate. But in this case, however, we could not increase the power density to a great extent. The modifications, however, did not give tremendous input. We also tried to modify the electrode using nickel anode by forming porous nickel anode using a template approach. So this and then we studied the bioelectrocatalysis of acetobacter acetate by direct electron transfer using this template deposited nickel anode. Then you can see the results. We tried two different fuels, glucose and ethanol, using carbon paper. CP is carbon paper, then the nickel carbon paper, then the porous carbon nickel, coated on carbon paper. And you can see the porous nickel based electrodes have given rise to a very good current conversion efficiency of 20.36% in the case of glucose and 56.56% in the case of ethanol. So the modification of the electrode also helps to a large extent in increasing the power output. Also, we did the functionalization of electrochemically modified chitosan films with alginate and Prussian blue for enhanced performance of microbial fuel cells. Here we made use of the same combination, acetobacter and gluconobacter in the cathode compartment. Normally we make use of potassium ferricyanide as the electron acceptor in the cathode compartment. It cannot be regenerated. So we tried another method to coat the cathode electrode with a Prussian blue that can be regenerated in presence of dissolved oxygen. So this has also improved our Coulombic efficiency to a large extent. So this we have tried with three fuels, glucose, ethanol, and acetate. So this has improved the Coulombic efficiency of our process.
Sorry to interrupt you in between. Pardon? Reminder, ma'am.
How many more minutes do I have?
It's already 11 a.m. You can finish in another 1 or 2 minutes.
The final modification we have made was nickel foam modified with polyaniline, titanium carbide, and chitosan as anode material, where we got the maximum power output. In this case, we can achieve 18 watt per meter cube. So this polyaniline modification along with titanium carbide and chitosan has worked very well for us. Then coming to the last two slides, the outlook of this biofuel cells future. In addition to being used as waste to energy devices, they can also be, they are also suitable or becoming suitable for alternate power source. Power sources and can be used for monitoring devices in remote locations and powering electronic devices. And further, you can see in many of the labs, especially in Bristol University, you can see this kind of MFCs are used in robots that can be used to power power lights, etc. For example, in that university, they have produced electric power from urinals, which is used to provide power for lights for the toilets. So this increases the suitability of MFCs as alternative power sources. We can also think of a mobile scavenging MFC that can treat the organic waste in our neighborhood, and it can use this organic waste for its sustenance. So we can also think of creating such a kind of self-sustained MFC. So in addition to being a waste to energy device, it can also find its suitability in the coming days as an alternate power source. With this, I would like to conclude. Thank you for your kind attention. Once again, I thank the organizers for the time given to me.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing your knowledge and the evolving work with us. So we are really grateful to you, ma'am. And we have few questions in the chat box.
Okay.
So ma'am, first question is, how can we extract maximum amount of energy from MFCs?
Nowadays, mainly the maximum amount of energy depending upon the kinetics of the reaction, which is lower. The energy can be improved by suitable modification of the electrode by decreasing the resistance in the circuit. Also, nowadays, power management circuits are available. There are many power management devices which can improve or harvest the energy without loss from MFCs.
Okay. There are many questions. I'll take some important one. Another one is, ma'am, what is the best combination of feed for maximum power?
Combination of?
Feed.
I didn't get combination of what?
This is combination of feed for maximum power, the student has written.
Species are...
It is substrate in the anode chamber.
It depends on both sides. It should be optimized. Cathode, mainly it affects the power output to a large extent.
Okay. So another question is on electron transfer property and the efficiencies in MBFCs, ma'am.
Electron transfer properties and efficiencies. We need a good electrogenic bacteria. The kinetics of electron transfer should be fast because it is limited by the charge transfer polarization of the bacteria. So if the bacteria, the redox portion of the bacteria has sufficient potential, redox potential, and if it transfers at a greater speed to the electrode surface, then we can improve the efficiency. And we should have, or in short, it should be a very good electrogen.
Okay. All right. Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your valuable time and sharing your knowledge. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.
So after this wonderful lecture, we all are fortunate to have Dr. S. Gajalakshmi as our next speaker. So before listening to her, let me take the privilege to introduce you all with Dr. S. Gajalakshmi. Till that time, I request ma'am to present her PPT. So Dr. S. Gajalakshmi is assistant professor and head at Center for Pollution Control and Environmental Engineering, Pondicherry University, Puducherry, India. She is PhD in environmental science and engineering from Pondicherry University in 2003. She was gold medalist in BSc and MSc at Pondicherry University. Her major research area is solid waste management, microbial fuel cells, and domestic and industrial vermifiltration. She has published more than 50 research papers in national and international journals, presented more than 20 papers in the conferences and seminars, authored one book and have written 10 chapters in books. She has 2 patents to her credit, and she has guided 21 AmPhil, 27 AmTech, and 14 PhD students. So it's our privilege to hear Dr. S. Gajalakshmi. So over to you, ma'am.
Hello, am I audible and my presentation is visible?
Yes, ma'am, you are well audible and your presentation is visible.
Thank you. Before I start, very good morning to all the participants. And I thank the organizers, Dr. Soumya, Dr. Abhilasha, and Dr. Deepak Jadhav for having given me this opportunity to address a very big group of participants at this time where we are idling actually at home. Thank you very much, ma'am and sirs. The topic I would present today is microbial fuel cells integrated technology for treating different types of wastewater, with emphasis on the cost of the cost effectiveness of the system. I'm Dr. Gajalakshmi from Center for Pollution Control and Environmental Engineering. Ours is a small center with only 3 faculty. The center was established in the year 1991, and we are offering MTech Environmental Engineering and Management course and PhD Environmental Technology and Environmental Engineering. And the research focus of the center is design, optimization, and development of eco-friendly technologies to promote sustainable development. So the topic, as I said earlier, is microbial fuel cells integrated technology. And I'm sharing what we are working on microbial fuel cells to cut down the cost towards investment. So that aspect is the one which I'm going to talk about. So first, microbial fuel cells, as we have seen, Dr. Sheila just now has detailed very nicely about what are the components and what are the plus and minus of the system. So microbial fuel cells, to put in a simple word, is a technology for harvesting electricity from the organic waste by the action of microorganisms. And it has 4 components: the anode, the cathode, proton exchange membrane, and the external electrical circuit. So the anode is placed in anaerobic condition where oxidation of organic matter takes place, which results in the release of protons and electrons. As you can see in the picture over here, organics converted into CO2 plus water, electron released and proton released. So the electron transfers to the cathode under aerobic condition via the external circuit. And the electrons produced by the microorganisms are transferred to the anode by the electron shuttles, direct membrane associated electron transfers or nanowires, and so on. And the protons that is produced transfers to the through the proton exchange membrane, combines with the electrons and oxygen and produces water. So this is a simple principle behind the functioning of the microbial fuel cell. So essentially, I'm concentrating on MFC integrated technologies, where we have tried to integrate compatible technologies to enhance the performance of the MFC along with the other integrated technology. So we have the plant-based microbial fuel cell. Then we have the constructed wetland microbial fuel cell, sediment microbial fuel cell. Then we have the MFC integrated with algal bioreactor, membrane bioreactor microbial fuel cell. We have the desalination microbial fuel cell, MFC-based electron photon process, and MFC with photocatalytic oxidation, and so on. I will be dealing with 4 aspects in this talk. So before going into the details, we have to look into the advantages and the limitations or the challenges involved with this, with the MFC and the integrated technologies. So the advantages as such using MFC is that we achieve wastewater treatment with concurrent bioelectricity production and biomass production if it is plant-based or algal-based systems, then there is no competition for land because it can be integrated with the existing water treatment plants itself. And it's a system which can be easily installed anywhere. And if you see, look at the long-term advantages, we have the biosense, it can, MFC's integrated technologies can be used as biosensor for environmental monitoring. There is no combustion or extra green gas, greenhouse gas emissions during the electricity production. Therefore, this lead to the sustainable development. And it also can balance the water, energy, and food nexus, especially in the plant-based MFCs, especially with the paddy fields, which I will be elaborating a little later. Of course, any system has its own advantages and also disadvantages or the limitations. So the challenges associated with MFC integrated technology is that we need to focus on the design of efficient and cost-effective configuration. We are able to reach a very efficient and as well as a cost-effective configuration. The cost, the reason is mainly because of the cost of the electrode materials. We have electrodes, we use electrodes which are very expensive. And most of the systems offer high internal resistance. So we need to have a system which doesn't, which offers lesser internal resistance. And if it is the long-term, if you see, if it is a plant-based system, then vitality of the plant needs to be maintained as well as we need to have a stable power output, which is very difficult to achieve. And there is other problem with the MFCs is that the electrode material deterioration, which we are having problem with. So we need to choose materials which are sustainable. And obviously the main other biggest limitation or challenge is the scale-up issues associated with the microbial fuel cell. So the focus of the study on the NFC and integrated technology should be towards design and development of low-cost configuration, optimization of composite ceramic separators, development of non-platinum electrocatalysts, because the best efficient electrocatalyst being used is the platinum based. And as we all know, platinum electrocatalysts are very expensive. So we need to go for development of non-platinum but sustainable electrocatalysts. And the system should be in such a way that it can treat industrial wastewater, it can treat domestic wastewater, or even systems which are focused towards human urine valorization. And the other aspect which we are focusing is plant-based microbial fuel cell, especially paddy field, use of the plant-based microbial fuel cell in paddy field for the recovery of nutrients, energy, and water, which we have abbreviated as NEW. And then scale up of the MFC and study on long-term sustainability of the MFC integrated technology. So focus should be on the low-cost configuration. So we are trying to do away with the commercially available membranes like Synaxion membranes. And we try to use a composite ceramic separators, which are obviously lower in cost. And we have made studies for optimizing the composite ceramic separators. So before going into the actual experimental part, I would like to show the way the composite ceramic separators have been made. So the terracotta membranes were prepared from locally available clay by paste pressing method. And the physicochemical properties of these membranes were assessed on the MFC performance. Then the effect of membrane firing temperature on the ohmic resistance, ionic conductivity, and the power generated by the terracotta MFCs were tested. And the other important aspect is the effect of membrane thickness on the MFC performance. So all this have been studied and optimized. So the raw clay mixture was, it was ball milled and sieved to get a uniform particle size clay material that was mixed with water in different standardized ratios and made into a paste. Therefore, we got a homogeneous clay paste that was loaded into metal cast of specific thickness and was pressed. And as a result, we get the raw clay membrane. And this raw clay membrane was subjected to room temperature for 48 hours and then fired at different temperature regimes to get the terracotta membrane. And then we have incorporated this terracotta membrane into the MFC, and we have got the terracotta separator equipped MFC. So this terracotta was further used for other experiments. So the designs which we have developed towards low cost configuration is, we have made ceramic based membrane plus chassis, cylindrical chassis as a body of the reactor. Also we have made with this ceramic substance, the terracotta based. One is the ceramic based membrane, other is the chassis. So together it is ceramic based membrane cum chassis. So essentially I will be talking on the MFC, the constructed wetland MFC, plant based MFC and algal MFC. So the first one is the microbial fuel cell, which is a conventional single and double chamber microbial fuel cell, but with the ceramic separator, which has been optimized in our laboratory. Then we have the sequential continuous microbial fuel cell octave. And then we have tubular ceramic MFC treating human urine. The second part which we will be dealing is on the configuration of hybrid constructed wetland microbial fuel cell, of course, with terracotta-based ceramic separator. And the third aspect is the plant microbial fuel cell, where I'll be discussing on the green walls, PMFC, that is plant microbial fuel cell with separator electrode assembly. Then we have the resource, new resource recovery by tubular PMFC, that is the nutrient, energy and water resource recovery with specifically with the polyfield. And then plant microbial fuel cell embedded Ola irrigation system, suitable for arid regions, dry regions. And the fourth aspect is the algal microbial fuel cell, which is where we'll be discussing on the terracotta membrane-based MFC with algal biocathode, MFC integrated algal bioreactor, and the photosynthetic microbial desalination cell. So the first one, as I said, these are the conventional MFCs, single chambered and the double chambered, but with the ceramic membrane which we have used. This is a sequential continuous microbial fuel cell octave, where you can see an inlet here. The wastewater is made to enter into this and is made to flow through several units. And then there's an outlet. So the water gets treated and the power is generated during the process. And this is specifically for treating human urine, valorization of human urine, where we have tubular microbial fuel cell. You can see the tubular reactors with the ceramic chassis inside it. The microbial fuel cell is over here. And the salts from the urine, which passes into the ceramic membrane, or we call it ceramic torch, is collected. It diffuses into due to different forces like electroosmotic trap, diffusion, and several other mechanisms, and they get accumulated in the as catalyte inside the ceramic chassis, and that is being collected. And you know that from urine we can derive struvite, which can be used for several other purposes as fertilizer and so on. So these are some of the configurations on the microbial fuel cell which we have. So next is the constructed wetland microbial fuel cell. As we all know, constructed wetland is an ecological system reported to be easily operated, doesn't require any chemicals for its functioning. They are less expensive, they do not produce odors, and more importantly, they have an advantage of aesthetic value. But the whole process involves complex ecological principles, but it is a mechanically simple system. So we try to incorporate the constructed wetland with the MFC. Of course, there are other authors who have worked on, pioneers in this field, and we have tried to improvise the system for better output. So in this, we have tried a kind of a pilot scale, about 75 to 100 liters system, because there's the reports, previously available reports, has some small problems. So we tried to study what was the problem and try to improvise the design. Because some people say with patch mode, the disadvantage with the constructed wetland integrated MFC is there is increased internal resistance. And in continuous mode, there was good high, power density, but the COD removal was not very efficiently achieved. So keeping all this in mind, we have designed this reactor where we have 9 individual upflow reactors with cathode chamber with horizontal flow. As you can see, there is constructed wetland MFC 1, we have 2, we have 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. And we can also see constructed wetland alone as a control where there is no MFC incorporated. It will have only the beds and the gravel, sand, etc., and the plant. And we have on the other side the SMFC, which is sediment microbial fuel cell. That is, everything will be the same except that there will be no plants. And this is another kind of control to see the performance. So the integration of constructed wetland and the MFC has given additional energy production along with good wastewater treatment efficiency. And the plant which we have used is the Typha augustifolia. You can see from the picture that there is common cathode chambers, 2 common cathode chambers for all the MFCs over here. That is to cut down the on the cost of the reactors. And then GAC, that is a granular activated carbon anode, was used, and the graphite felt rhizosphere cathode. If you can see the previous one, this one, this is an individual reactor where you can see the reactor made up of gravel and sand. You have the robo portion where we have the anode, the GAC anode. You can see the clayware separator in the gravel bed, and on the top we have the gravel, sand, and the cathode, and we have the plants over here. So the graphite felt rhizosphere, it is a graphite felt rhizosphere cathode. So this is about the constructed wetland integrated with microbial fuel cell. So next comes the plant microbial fuel cell. So the plant microbial fuel cell we have, you can see the first picture where you have the ceramic charges, the ceramic separator assembly. And you can see on the right side, they're being coated with a black colored coating is over there. And these are actually the biochar. So one aspect which we have seen is on the membrane, we have cut down the cost towards Nefion membrane and tried to work with the ceramic membrane. The other aspect is we have tried to work on low cost electrode material where we are using the biochar, because commercially available electrodes are very expensive, they are of low biocompatibility, and they are non-renewable in nature. So and this is one of the major constraints for MFC scale up and performance as scale up especially. So for bringing down the cost towards the electrode material, we have explored biochar as the low cost electrode material. So biochars can be used as low cost material. We have tried to derive biochar from plant material like Prosopis juliflora, bamboo, etc. So these biochars were used as MFC electrodes, and this significantly not only reduces the cost towards the make of the MFC, but also it reduces the carbon footprint. So the biochar from this biomass reduces the energy and the carbon footprint associated with electrode manufacturing, and the disposal of which would have been of additional agronomic benefits. So for that reason, we have tried to use biochar as electrode material. So biochar was derived from bamboo prosopis, and the biochar was characterized, and it was found that it has even distribution of macro and meso porosity. And here we have used stainless steel mesh and wire as current collectors, and the surface morphology and the functional groups were studied. And you can see in this picture where you have the anode and the cathode. Cathode is the biochar which is scouted outside, and the plant being grown. And the biochar is packed in a stainless steel mesh as anodic material and kept inside. And the biochar is coated to graphite film on the outside of the terracotta membrane, which is used as the air cathode. So the next one you can see is the hydroponic MFC hydroponic system. This is for treating domestic wastewater, where it can be suitable for kind of system which where we can go for wastewater treatment in our own way for decentralized systems. So this is the MFC embedded hydroponic system, where the wastewater is made to flow through.
Are you there? Gajalakshmi ma'am, we cannot hear you. Are you there, ma'am? Yeah, I think there is some technical error. Yeah, ma'am is back. Please have patience, everybody.
Hello, ma'am. Is it okay now?
Yeah, ma'am. It is good. Okay. Ma'am, can make it full screen, please, ma'am.
Yeah, I'm doing. Yeah, this is a Ceratec system where you have the wastewater in the bottom structure, which you can see. And through the wick, the plant grows. Again, this is suitable for a very small treatment system. You can keep indoors. The power that is generated can be utilized for powering a clock. This is the indoor air purifier plant. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am, you are audible. Now you are audible. Yes.
Okay, I don't know, some problem over here. So next one, next one is the Ola irrigation system. So this is Ola pots. Ola pots are traditionally used in arid regions where, for irrigation. They keep water filled inside the pot and keep it buried in the soil. And the diffusion of water from the pots is utilized by the plants for their growth. This is for conserving water. So this Ola pot we have used for wastewater treatment and incorporating it with the MFC. So Ola pot derived by was buried in the soil, keeping the mouth open, and it was filled with the wastewater. So this wastewater, the organic matter from the wastewater would be utilized by the microorganisms for wastewater treatment, and the water would be used for the plant growth. Here, carbon felt oven with stainless steel wire was wrapped around the pot and used as cathode, and the inside the pot, it is the anode. So the cathodic reaction is done by use of oxygen liberated by the plant root system. So here we have used a tomato plant for the plant growth. These are Ola pots buried in the soil. The plant used is the tomato plant. So this we can use in regions where there is a need for conservation of water. So next in the line is the nutrient energy and water resource recovery from the paddy field using PMFCs. As I said, PMFCs are integrated to the paddy field to recover nutrient, energy, and water. Hello, ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, you are audible. With your, make your screen full screen, please. Again, gone in the PPT mode.
This is the nutrient, energy, and water recovery from the paddy field. As I had said earlier, paddy fields we know are waterlogged systems, and this waterlogged system, there are use of several fertilizers and water. So we try to recover water and nutrients from these systems, of course, because of the microbial fuel cells as energy that is produced, which can be utilized. So terracotta cylinders were used as the chassis and the proton exchange membrane, and they were placed in the paddy field horizontally and vertically to see which is more efficient. And there's catholyte recovery because of electroosmotic drag, reverse osmosis, and diffusion, and several other processes. There will be collection of catholyte inside. And when we characterize this catholyte, it was found that they had nutrients like ammonium and clay minerals recovered. So there's nutrients, there's water which comes inside, and also energy that is created. So we put it as nutrient, energy, and water resource recovery from the paddy field. So the concentration gradient-driven diffusion and electrical field-induced migration of the water and cations across the membranes help in the recovery of water, chemicals, and removal efficiency of nitrogen compounds from water. Because in paddy field, urea is used and there's always remaining urea unutilized by the plants in the paddy field. So that can be recovered and reused. So this is one kind of study which we have been working. And more importantly, another aspect is using microbial fuel cell actually reduces the emission of the greenhouse gas, especially the methane from this field. That is because there is electrogenesis happening on one side, there's methanogenesis happening on the other side. So ecologically, it is reported and it has been found that electrogenesis is ecologically superior to methanogenesis, and this electrogenesis takes over. So when there is this reduces the methane production and increases the electrical output. So there are reports which says that the current generation decreased the methane emission in the paddy field by half or half. So there are various reports, and the maximum they say it is reduces the methane emission by half. So the next presentation is on the microbial desalination cell. So I want to focus on the photosynthetic microbial fuel cell. This is a similar kind of cell, microbial desalination cell, and then I will go into the photosynthetic desalination cell. So this, as you can see over here, we have the microbial desalination cell, which has three components, the anode, the cathode, and the desalination chamber. And this technology integrates desalination along with wastewater treatment without any external energy. It was started, I mean, they have Penn State University of US and Tsinghua University of China has been working extensively on this in these reactors. And we can see an anode chamber. So the microorganisms in the anode chamber oxidizes the organic matter in the wastewater, generating protons and electrons. And the electrons are oxidized in the cathode. And this oxidation reduction results in the development of potential gradient. And thus current is produced. And the movement of protons towards cathode is restricted by the anode exchange membrane. So this allows only the passage of negatively charged ions. So to maintain charge balance, the anions from the desalination chamber, like chlorine or sulfate, in this case it is Cl minus ions because we have NaCl saline water over here. So it moves to the anode chamber from the middle desalination chamber. And at cathode, protons are removed from the water, and so there is movement of cations like Na plus sodium ions and say calcium ions from the desalination chamber. Here we have sodium because again the saline water. So this goes to the cathode chamber to balance the charge. Therefore, desalination takes place. But the limitation with this is scale up and commercialization because of low desalination efficiency and low reduction reaction in the cathode chamber. So in cathode chamber, we need to use energy extensive aeration for oxygen. So for this, either we need to aerate, or we need to use terminal electron acceptors like ferricyanide. So in case we use aeration, then it adds to the cost of the reactor configuration. And if you use ferricyanide, it's going to import toxicity to the reactor, to the microorganisms over there. So if it would be better if oxygen is generated in situ, there itself. So here comes the role of the microalgae, because they generate photosynthetic oxygen. Therefore, we can add microalgae in the cathode chamber, and therefore the existence of the microbial photosynthetic MFC. So this picture is the microbial photosynthetic microbial fuel cell, where you can see cathode chamber, desalination chamber, and the anode chamber. And as explained earlier, there's movement of sodium into the cathode, cathode chamber, and chlorine into the anode chamber. And we have used the freshwater marine microalgae halophytic species, Celidesmus dimorphus. So these are the different, the last one is a photosynthetic microbial desalination cell. Then we have used terracotta membrane-based tubular and dual chamber algal NFCs. And also we are trying with tubular microbial fuel cell coupled algal photo bioreactor. So many of the systems which you are using now are linear approach. So we need to go for a circular economy approach. So this is a model which we are proposing for a circular economy approach, for especially targeted towards a domestic wastewater for small households or a small community where the wastewater generated can be treated using hybrid MFC reactor with macrophyte setup, using the ceramic separators and electrode assembly. And then it can be further treated with Wormy filter coupled MFC system. So that can be one aspect. And that can be further, the water treated with the other systems can be used in aquaponics, where further the water can be utilized for the growth of fishes, and that can bring in some economy, and it can be further treated with UV treatment, and then it can be thought of using for flushing, recycling, and gardening at household purposes. So with this, I conclude the presentation. I once again thank the organizers for having given me this opportunity. Thank you. Over to the organizers.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you very much for this informative and interesting talk.
And, thank you.
Yes, ma'am. We are, I'm taking few questions, ma'am.
Yeah, sure, ma'am.
First question is, ma'am, this is from Sagar student. How much maximum amount of electricity can we generate from this type of MFC?
Actually, as in any MFC, this is also a limitation. It's not more than we don't even reach 1,000 millivolts. Hello.
Okay.
So we are trying to improvise the systems further. And be more focused on the wastewater treatment, resource recovery, all that, because so that the system is not, it's affordable to work out with.
Okay.
The focus cannot be only energy. If it is only energy, then we are not very successful.
Yeah, very right, very good. Next question is, ma'am, how PMFC reduces the urea level in the paddy fields?
Actually, it doesn't reduce the urea level. The excess level, which is present outside, due to electroosmotic drag and diffusion, other several processes, enter into the ceramic chamber, and it gets collected there. So we have, as a catholyte, along with water, this we have characterized, and it is ammonium and clay minerals present, and that is because of the conversion of the urea into ammonia, which has come inside the chamber. So we can collect the excess urea in this way and reuse it.
Okay.
We can further refine it and use depending on the composition.
All right. And another question is, ma'am, in Ola irrigation system, what if the roots of the plants we are growing goes into the pot in which we hold the water and breaks there? Means how feasible will be the system?
The plants are planted beside the pot. It's not inside the pot. It's outside. And we are going to try in the field in near future. So there'll be more space. So it'll be a natural system. So there's no constraint of space for the roots to come in, break the pot.
Okay. And another question is, ma'am, can we do the simulation of this type of microbial fuel cell reactors?
Yeah, once we optimize the parameters, yes, we can do. Because the kinetics is available. Only thing we have to optimize the parameters influencing, then we can.
Okay. And ma'am, have you studied microbial activity in the vicinity of plant roots, which might contribute for energy generation?
From literature, it is a Geobacter and the Chevenella species. We are now actually, because of the lockdown, we are stuck up with this. We were starting the microbial work, but we couldn't do it. But from literature, it is a Geobacter and the Chevenella species.
So any software is available, ma'am, for the simulation?
No, we have not worked with yet.
Okay. And ma'am, another question is, how to deal with loss of ammonia on degradation of urea while handling urine for the valorization?
Sorry? We can do ammonia stripping.
Okay. All right, ma'am. And this last question I'll take, ma'am.
Sure.
This topic is very interesting, and it's need for today's growing population. Can you discuss hurdles for technology transfer, and can we develop small scale setup for fulfillment of energy requirement of a house like solar panel setup? Is there actually, any initiative till date?
There are studies there have been. We have actually installed these NFCs for the urine valorization at our center. From the gents toilet, we are doing it. And the pilot scale of the constructed wetland and the paddy field is a very large area which we have studied. Other than that, we have not gone into a very large scale yet. Okay. But there are possibilities we are going into.
All right, ma'am. All right. Thank you so much for taking all the questions, ma'am. Thank you so much for your interesting talk.
Thank you so much. And once again, thank the organizers for having given me the opportunity and the other administrators of the Sharda University and the Maharashtra Institute of Technology. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Yeah. So after this informative talk, let's move ahead and sending greetings from the EFDP, I introduce you all to our next speaker, that is Dr. Suresh Babu Pasupuleti. And I request sir to please present his presentation till the time I take the privilege to introduce you. So Dr. Suresh Babu is currently working as Scientist C, Deputy Director at Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Eastern Regional Office, Bhubaneswar. He has done his M.Tech in Industrial Pollution Control from NIT Karnataka and PhD under the supervision of Dr. S. Venkatamohan, Senior Principal Scientist, CSIR IICT Hyderabad. During his PhD tenure, he also worked at VITO Belgium on bioelectrochemical systems. He was also involved in upscaling and designing a 10-liter pilot scale biohydrogen producing reactor. His research resulted in 13 SCI publications and one book chapter. So with this small introduction, sir, I request you to take over the frame. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for nice introduction. Is it my presentation is sharing?
No, sir, it's not yet visible. Sir, you open your presentation first.
Yes, I open.
And then you can share the screen. On the platform you are, you can see at the bottom there is option of share screen.
Yes.
You can see few options at the bottom, sir. That is security, participants, chat, share screen.
Yeah, I am trying, but my computer is not allowing to share the screen.
You got the option of share screen, sir?
Yeah, I got the option, but my system is not allowing to share the screen.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Take it easy. One second. Yeah. I'm so sorry. Please give me 5 minutes.
That's okay, sir. Sometimes happens. Meanwhile, I'd like to interact with our participants. Hope everybody is enjoying the sessions, and we have very wonderful sessions in the morning, two sessions we heard. And they are really enlightening, and the way the speakers have taken the questions is really, really wonderful and appreciable. So I request you all to keep your energy high, because this is the only platform to learn and to have context, to grow with the energy, to get that spark to do something, and you get a lot of information. Yeah, yes, sir. And I request all the participants, whatever questions coming in your mind, please do write in the chat box. We'll take your questions one by one. So I've seen in between that some few of the participants are raising their hands, as I can see. So I request all the participants, please, instead of raising hand, do write your question in the chat box, because we have lots of participants and it's there that we may miss them at the time of questioning. So better you put all your questions in the chat box. We'll take your questions.
We had two sessions in morning from Dr. Sheila. So she explained about how microbial field cells can be useful for the laboratory scale applications. And she also detailed about how these challenges can be overcome by operating, maintaining the operating condition. Further, in second talk, we have Dr. S. Gajalakshmi from Central University Pondicherry. She also explained about how different variations or different configurations in microbial fuel cells, such as Ola MFC, Percepted Wetland MFC, Paddy Field MFC, Plant MFC, as well as various kinds of ceramic tetrakota MFC. And she also had shared some experimental results from her lab. She also discussed how we can go for optimization the operating conditions in microbial fuel cells, and also treatment of urine in microbial fuel cells.
So, thank you for taking the key takeaways, sir. Yes, sir. Please continue, sir.
Over these two sessions, both the speakers, they have generally explained how this microbial fuel cell is working at lab scale, and what are the current existing challenges that existing current researcher is focusing, and how we can overcome these challenges. So both sessions was interesting from Sheila Madam as well as from Dr. Gajalakshmi Madam, and also our next expert, Dr. S. Suresh Babu. So he is also one of the experts in this microbial electrolysis, microbial biophysical systems. So here we are waiting for him to join for our session.
Will join us soon. Sorry, I request you all to keep patience. I request you all to be here, please. We are starting in few minutes. Sir is facing some issues and sharing his screen. We are trying to sort it out. We are starting in few minutes. Dear participants, greetings from EFDP cum workshop on waste to bioenergy. We apologize for the delay in the talk due to network issues. Please be with us. Thank you. Dear participants, thank you for your patience and being with us. There was some technical error Sar is facing. So probably his with his PPT. We can see his PPT now. Dr. Suresh Babu, can you hear me?
Hello. Am I audible now?
Yes, now you are audible, sir. Yes.
Yeah, I am so sorry for the technical delay because there is a firewall content in my laptop. It is not allowing to share. And thank you for the nice introduction. Myself, Dr. Suresh Babu, facility working as NTC and Deputy Director at Eastern Regional Office, Minister of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Bhuvaneshwar. So today we are going to discuss about the scaling up of estrogenic and bioelectrogenic process for renewable energy and waste remediation. Moreover, especially we are speaking about the challenges I faced during my PhD tenure. I'm going to discuss about them and moreover other challenges also we are going to discuss. Before going to the presentation, I would like to let you know that my presentation is split into two parts. One is microbial fuel cell technology, especially upscaling issues. And second one is a acidogenic biohydrogen production process. So first of all, the microbial fuel cell operations. Major microbial fuel cell designs used in the field are single chamber fuel cell and double chamber fuel cells. Single chamber fuel cells used majority of the researchers because of its simple in design and easy in operation. Whereas though double chamber fuel cell is efficient, but single chamber is economically viable and easy to operate. Coming to the mechanism of MFC operation, going to fundamentals of the reactions, once again, I want to recall the reactions, where the anodic reaction take place at the anode chamber, the organic matter in the form of glucose or any degradable organic matter dissolved in the wastewater will split into three parts. One is hydrogen ions, electrons, and carbon dioxide. The protons, the hydrogen ions will transfer through proton exchange membrane to cathode by presence of oxygen at cathode chamber, and electrons will pass through anode to cathode through external circuit, where at the cathodic reaction, it will come, both electrons and proton will combine with the oxygen and forms a water molecule. And the overall reaction is organic matter splitted into electrons and protons, and final products are carbon dioxide, water, and with add-on electrical energy. The major reactions occur at the anode chamber, where by the electron transfer from bacteria to anode is by majorly two mechanisms. One is direct electron transfer mechanism, another one is the mediated electron transfer mechanism. In mediated electron transfer mechanism, the electrons will transfer from bacteria to electrode by involvement of mediators. These are called redox mediator. There are a number of redox mediators released by the bacteria based on their nature and the circumstances of the operating condition. Whereas in direct electron transfer, there are two types are there. One is the direct transfer of electron by bacteria to electrode surface and through conductive nanowires, extended nanowires. These are the basic mechanism of microbial fuel cell. Where I feel my electron will be transferred from to anode by electroactive biofilm formed on the surface of the anode. We can consider this biofilm as an extended electrode, where substrate will interact with the biofilm and the biofilm will transfer the ions to the electrodes, both cathode and anode. So more or less, if you take any amount of volume, if it is 1 liter, 100 liter, it doesn't matter. But I feel majority of the reaction, more or 90% of the reaction occurs at the interfacial region between anode and electrode and electrolyte. This biofilm area, it is very thin, very, very thin, more, not even 0.1 mm also, if I'm correct. So for this, we want to know the interactions between electrode surface area and electrolyte. What is the relation? For this, we conducted an experiment called influence of electrode surface area to analyte volume. So here we took three electrode surface areas of anode, whereas one is the 5.6 and one is the 16.8 and one is the 28 centimeter square of the surface areas. Whereas cathode surface is common for all, which is 28 centimeter square. Membrane we used is an Nafion 117 membrane. The individual cell volumes are 56 ml, and overall cell is the 112 ml. This is the schematic design of the cell we used in this study. This is the anode chamber and this is the cathode chamber. I would like to inform you that this is the we operated in single chamber mode of operation, where air is being flushed to the cathode chamber. There is no catalyst involved except natural air. So So this is the analyte, and the distance between the both electrodes are 2 cm, where membrane is placed towards the cathode and away from the anode side. So both are parallel to each other. And this is the feed tank. It is being operated in continuous mode operation. There is, the only difference here are the anode projected surface area. There are no other differences. Differences are changed. There are no other differences. The external surface, the external resistant we used is 1 kΩ, and acetate 1 g/L is used as a feed to the bacteria. So coming to the by this experiment, we can correlate the relations between the cathode and anode surface areas also. Here we used in the SPV ratio of 0.1, we used 20% of the cathode surface area. At 0.3, we used 60% of the cathode surface area. At 0.5, we used 100% of the cathode surface area. It means both surface areas are equal. So these are the electrogenic performance. We are able to record up to 0.8 watt per meter square of power density after stabilization of the cell. If you see the cell design point where the internal resistance is equivalent to external resistance, if you increase the anode surface area, the cell design point is increased. Thus, if you have to operate at higher resistance, whereas with the lower lower surface area, lower cell design point is recorded. It means that the resistance between the internal resistance between the anode and cathode and electrolyte are very minimal if you operate at lower anodic surface area. And these are the cyclic voltagrams. So cyclic voltagrams are is a technique to use the find the quantum of electroactive bacteria are present on the surface area and relation between the applied voltage and the recorded current. So these flat lines are recorded at the time of open circuit, at the time of stabilizing open circuit operating condition, means without any we added the bacteria to the cell, but we didn't connect the cell externally. We operated in the open circuit condition. Clearly, this S-shaped curve is a turnover curve. S-shaped curve indicates the after fully stabilized cell. That means after stabilizing and recorded higher power density, like these conditions, we recorded the cyclic voltagram at 0.5 milliwatt per meter square speed. So it is very visible that the electroactive bacteria is well developed after stabilizing the performance of the cell, and this curve indicate this area is the more or less reactive area where acetate react to between 0.3 to minus 0.4 volts of applied voltage. So there are some peaks. These peak means that involvement of mediators during oxidation and reduction phase. In all the three cells, more or less similar peaks, similar mediators were involved, but where at open circuit operating condition. But at closed circuit operating condition, there are no visible, but very few visible peaks are present. But that such a typical visible peaks are not available after stabilization of the fuel cell. You can see this figure. This is the comparison between three cells cyclic voltagrams after it's fully stabilized. There are no much difference between these voltagrams except a very few currents of catalytic current. But if you want to find the what is the exact response from the bacteria, we need to do the first order derivative of these cyclic voltagrams. If you do that, you can visibly find the difference between three cells, where this is the oxidative current and this is the reductive current, where at the applied voltage of minus point, this is generally acetate acetate oxidized voltage, where the bacteria is responding both for oxidation electron transfer and reduction electron transfer. These are the three cells profile. If you compare between three cells, the lower anodic surface area of the cell recorded higher response compared to other two, whereas other two are very much lower than this cell. This means lower the anodic surface area than the equivalent to the cathode, or lower the anode surface area will result the higher electrogenic activity of the fuel cell. And coming to the bioprocess analysis, if you see this curve, this is the effluent pH conductivity and COD removal efficiency. There is no much difference between COD removal efficiency and effluent pH, but there is a variation in the effluent conductivity, where lower the surface area, higher electron conductivity, because higher electroactivity between the electrolyte and electrode. Coming to the major part, the energy conversion efficiency. One is the Coulombic efficiency, one is the energy conversion efficiency we calculated. For the lower surface area, we reached more than 80% of the conversion efficiency. If you increase the volume surface area of the cell, the efficiency is decreased. These are the other parameters which supports the performance of the fuel cell parameters. And another important parameter is the type of the electrode we select for the upscaling of the microbial fuel cell or operational of the microbial fuel cell. For this, we have conducted a development of electroactive biofilm role and what its role on MFC performance. This work conducted at Vito, Belgium under supervision of Dr. S. Venkat Mohan, under supervision of Dr. Deepak Mant. I did my research under Dr. S. Venkat Mohan, CSR ICT Hyderabad, and I got selected a Vito Belgium Fellowship and worked for 10 months under supervision of Dr. Deepak Pant, Belgium. So we have selected seven types of electrodes, where six are carbon-based electrodes, and another one is the metal electrode, which is the SS mesh. This is the graphite plate, and this is the carbon plate, and Vito core electrode, Vito case one electrode, Vito case two electrode. These are the chemically fabricated electrodes, where the composition varies from each other. And this is the general electrode we used in MFC operations, which is the carbon cloth. We poised a 0.2 potential on each electrode by using potential stack, and we fed acetate as a feedstock, and we placed, this is the reactor cell, it's a tubular cell. We placed each electrode perpendicular to cross-section of the cell and 1.5 centimeters apart from each other. So by applying potential, we recorded current generation for about 65 days. And this is the overall current production from each electrode, where this is the maximum current density recorded against each electrode. This is the Vito case electrode recorded a higher current density after stabilization of the cell. And these are the cyclic voltagrams, where Vito carbon cloth, Vito case two electrode, Vito case one electrode, and Vito core electrode recorded higher current densities compared to other electron. And there is a visible mediators involved in both carbon cloth and Vito case two electrode, whereas Vito core one and Vito case one electrodes are peaks are not visible because of presence of captive current. In MFC, when you apply a potential to the electrode, there is a current called captive current, means the electrode itself produces some current in response to the applied voltage. It doesn't belong to the bacteria performance and electrolyte. Electrode itself will produce some current, internal captive current to the potential stat. I will show you how it is. And this is the scanning electron microscopy for the graphite electrode. These two are the abiotic electrodes, where there is no bacteria. This is the virgin electrodes. This is the surface. You can see that there is a shining part on the electrode. This is called, it is responding to the applied voltage on the electrode. So it's that's how the captive current will record on the cyclic voltagrams. These below three graph pictures are after development of biofilm. These are the bacteria formed as a biofilm on the electrode's surface. This is for SS mesh. This is the cross-section of the single cross-section of the wires. This is the surface of the wire, and this is the formation of bacteria on the electrode. And this is the carbon felt. These are the carbon fibers of the electrode. And this is the formation of bacteria on the electrodes. And this is the Vito core electrode. This is the abiotic conditions, and these are the biotic conditions. And this is the Vito case electrode. This is the structure of the cell, surface of the electrode. And this is after formation of, this is the biofilm formation on the electrode surface area. And this is the Vito case two electrode. These are the structures, and this is the biotic condition. This is the carbon cloth, and this is the abiotic condition. This is the cross-section of the fibers on the, and it is after formation of a biofilm on the surface area. So this is about the selection of electrodes. We did one experiment on the applicability of matter suitable electrodes on the for the better performance. And later we feel that mode of operation also influence on the performance of MFC fuel cell and electricity output. For this, we conduct an experiment for optimizing the mode of operation. This is the schematic diagram of the microbial fuel cell used in the study. And this work also done at Vito, Belgium, under guidance of Dr. Deepak Pant. And this is these are the three, these are similar three cells are used for the experiment. One is operated for the batch mode and one for the semi-continuous mode of operation, one for the continuous mode of operation. So this is the one cell, this is operated batch mode operating condition, and this is the overall setup. This is the batch mode cell, and this is semi-continuous mode cell, and this is continuous mode cell. As per the previous experiment, and this in this experiment also, we only varied the mode of operation. The other conditions are all are same for each cell. So we recorded all the voltage and current, all the voltage by using biologic potentiostat, and we operated by closing the circuit. And this is the electrogenic profile. By we started at 5 kΩ and optimized with the 1 kΩ for each three cells. And individually parameters also varied. Like for batch mode of operation, operated with the different recirculation rates. And for the semi-continuous mode of operation, we operated with the different percentage of feed replacement. And for continuous mode, we operated with a variation of hydraulic retention time of each experiment. So after this, the continuous mode of operation at 10 hours of HRT resulted higher power density production. So we selected this as a operating condition for the stacking of the fuels, microbial fuel cell. These are the bioprocess profiles where batch mode of operation, of course, it will results higher removal COD removal efficiency, whereas continuous mode lower COD removal efficiency, but higher in energy conversion efficiency and the Coulombic efficiency. We selected the higher energy conversion efficiency as the optimal parameter for the considering 10 hours HRT as the optimum operating condition for stacking. So we combined the three fuel cells as a stack cell, and we operated individually by supplying feed, dark fermented to effluent used as the feed, and we supplied to each fuel cell individually, and we connected the fuel cells in by electric circuit mode, like series and parallel. In this experiment, because in parallel, we will obtain a higher amount of current, lower voltage, and in series connection, we obtain higher voltage and lower current density. So we selected a series mode of operation because majority of researchers do the same. So we selected them. This is the dark fermented to effluent characteristic we used for this study. So this is the fuel cell we operated in stack mode of operation. So this is the open circuit, means without applying external resistance to the circuit, and we operated in open circuit mode of operation where about 1.5 volts recorded from the three cells. As we know that, and after that we connected through three different resistance. One is 3 kΩ and 2 kΩ and 1 kΩ, where for the cell 2 kΩ recorded higher power density compared to other resistance. So these are the bioprocess analysis where the COD removal efficiency of above 80% we recorded, and effluent pH is more or less between 6.4 and 7. And conductivity is more or less equal to equal in all surface areas. So I would like to conclude that MFC can be upscaled by stacking approach only, where we can connect the fuel cells by connecting in series or in parallel connection, the as per the requirement of the end use. So in MFC operation, it will take a small microcell, or it's a big, like 100 meter cube reactor volume. It will, a single cell can produce only 1.2 volts only. So you cannot upscale the microbial fuel cell by volume. It should be by stacking approach only. But the design of the fuel cell depends on the type of electrode, the type of feed substrate you are using, and the type of cathode you are using, the amount of oxygen applicability to the cathode surface area and distance between the electrodes, and quantum carbon loading you are feeding to the reactor. These all parameters are depend on the influence the MFC performance. So as per the material availability and as per the substrate availability and load, we can maintain the load, but as per the type of the substrate you can design, we can optimize the fuel cell by conducting various experiments like type of fuel cells and distance between electrode. We can optimize the fuel cell, and we can stack each fuel cell by connecting number of fuel cells so that MFC performance and MFC energy can be utilized. This is about the MFC operation. Now I would like to discuss about isogenic fermentation for biohydrogen production, where biohydrogen production is possible for mainly by suppressing the methanogenic activity in the methane generation process, where isogenic we can remove the hydrogen from the reactor so that it will automatically block the methanogenic activity, and some pre-treatment methods as described by Dr. S. Venkat Mohan yesterday. So we can use the pre-treatment methods and we can suppress the methanogenic activity so that we can achieve the hydrogen production. But hydrogen production majorly of two, it follows majorly two pathways. One is the acetate pathway by this equation, where one mole of glucose will produce 4 moles of hydrogen. By butyric acid pathway, it is produced 2 moles of hydrogen. Theoretically, if you take 1 kg of COD, around 20.93 moles of hydrogen we can get. It is equivalent to 468 liters of hydrogen and around 0.042 kg of hydrogen. But there are number of parameters will influence the hydrogen production, like biocatalyst, organic loading rate, substrate feeding pH, reactor configuration and operation, hydraulic reduction time, temperature, hydrogen partial pressure, and metal ions. As I said, Dr. S. Venkat Mohan is very expert on the hydrogen production production process. He did lot of experiments on efficient hydrogen production by pre-treating the biocatalyst and by integrating various process methods. He already delivered a very good lecture on hydrogen production. But I want to focus on organic loading rate and temperature, how it will affect the hydrogen production. So coming to the temporary influence of temperature. For this, we conducted an experiment with 5 liters of total volume and 4 liters of working volume with 3 g/L of design synthetic waste. Glucose is a feed for the substrate with feeding pH of 6.0 and reduction time of 30 hours. This heating is maintained by inserted a coil inside the reactor, so that temperature of the substrate is maintained as desired. And this is the we also did the bioelectrochemical evaluation of enzymes are influencing the hydrogen production with respect to operating temperature. Coming to hydrogen production profiles, where 35 degree centigrade influenced on hydrogen production and recorded maximum hydrogen production of 65 ml per hour of 3 g/L glucose feed. This is the maximum hydrogen production rate we recorded at 8th hour, where the temperature increased, the rate of hydrogen production rate is increased, and lag phase, matlab hydrogen production rate production time at where at maximum recorded is also decreased from 30 hours to 8 hours, and later by increasing to 40 degree centigrade it got suppressed. So this is the overall hydrogen production, where we recorded more than 800 ml of hydrogen production with 35 degree centigrade of operation. This is the overall cumulative hydrogen production, 817.5. And coming to the overall performance with respect to biohydrogen and composition of biogas and maximum hydrogen production. If you see the 35 degree operating temperature, maximum hydrogen production recorded at this rate, and the composition of this hydrogen is more than 50% in the biogas. And lag phase time also decreased with increase in temperature. So at 35 degrees centigrade is the best operating temperature for biohydrogen production as per this experiment. And why it is happened at 35 degrees? We calculated, we also done the carboxylic analysis, carboxylic acids analysis, like volatile fatty acids, which pathway it is driven for hydrogen production. Suppose maximum carbolic acids are recorded at 35 degrees centigrade of 1020 milligram per liter. This is the system pH, this is the COD removal efficiency. So if you see the total carboxylic acid profiles, the acetate recorded higher at 35 degrees centigrade, where out of 1020 milligram per liter, more than 50% is the acetate acetic acid is produced. That means more than 50% is the more than 50% acetic acid pathway driven by the reactor bacteria and produced a higher hydrogen production at 35 degrees centigrade. And these are the cyclic voltammogram profiles. And these are, if you see the number of enzymes involved in, at 35 degree operating centigrade are more higher, more number of enzymes involved compared to other operating temperatures. Now coming to the influence of organic loading rate on hydrogen production. For this, we operated a semi-pilot scale reactor of having total volume of 34 liter, working volume is around 30 liter, 29.5 liters, and feeding volume is 18 liter. This is a coir biofilm reactor where coir material is inserted in between, concurrent to the center of the reactor. And batch mode operations, we operated with various organic loading rates. Here we used food waste as a feedstock, and we operated with the 6, 12, 18, 30, 40, 50, and 66 gram per liter, where at 50 gram per liter, we recorded higher biohydrogen production of more than 10 liter per hour, and later at a higher 66 gram per liter, it got decreased. If you see the maximum hydrogen production rate is, the time of maximum hydrogen production rate varies with the loading of organic food waste. And at a 66 gram per liter, it is suppressed because of pH value is below the 4.5, which is not feasible for hydrogen production. This is because of higher production of volatile fatty acids, which is more than 5,000 milligram per liter. Because higher the feeding rate, initially it will react with the feedstock, and higher production will, hydrogen production will occur. Simultaneously, higher VFE also will occur. Simultaneously, it will lower the pH. If lower pH is lower than the 4.5, optimal 4.5, then hydrogen production bacteria will be suppressed. And this is how the pH and relation between pH and hydrogen production rate, where at this point, it is lower the 4.5 and it is lower the hydrogen production. And we also did biochemical, electrochemical evaluation of this reactor with the variable organic loading rates, where involvement of various number of enzymes in the operation. So at a higher loading rate, the enzymes are not visible. So it is suppressed by pH of the system. And by taking these all results, we design, I involved up to design of a 10 meter cube capacity bioreactor. Now it is being operated at CSIRCT efficiently. And these are the hypothetical profiles of hydrogen production with the 10 meter cube reactor. As per our experiments, we achieved more than 50% of the hydrogen production rate. Here, if you see, sorry, that graph is, here, this one. If you see the hydrogen conversion efficiency, where 1 kg of COD will yield 0.042 kg of hydrogen, we calculated the hydrogen conversion efficiency based on the COD removal and the amount of hydrogen we produce. If you, each cycle operated for 7 days, if you take entire cycle for 50 gram per liter, it is around 30%. If you take 24 hours of the operation cycle, it is more than 50%. So based on our experiences in laboratory with the different hydrogen conversion efficiencies, we generally will take 30% as an average hydrogen conversion efficiency. For the 10 meter cube operating reactor, if you increase the organic wastewater organic loading rate, the hydrogen production rate will increase as per the applied organic loading rate, and hydrogen production cost will reduce and payback period will be reduced. So from this, I would like to say that hydrogen production is majorly a bit sensitive when you increase the volume of the reactor. If you go for a 10 meter cube, 100 meter cube, we have 1 MLD, the reaction rate will be very faster, and the time for the maximum hydrogen production reaching is will be reduced if you increase the volume of the reactor. Moreover, compared to suspended more biofilm operated, we have biofilm operated reactors yielded higher hydrogen conversion efficiencies. But maintaining biofilm operating at 100 meter cube is a bit challenging. And moreover, feeding pH and organic loading rate for 100 meter cube or 10 meter cube, to achieve that much organic load, we need huge amount of wastewater with the higher organic matter present in the wastewater. This is a bit challenging points. I will give some suggestion to achieve that point. So next thing I wanted to tell you is, but at present hydrogen production is not commercially usable for the transportation for facilities where the storage and efficient fuel cells or efficient process for the practical applicability of the hydrogen driven vehicles are yet to come in the market. So one thing we can add some amount of hydrogen to the methane, the present CNG powered vehicles, so that it will increase the efficiency of the engine and efficiency of the mileage of the vehicle and efficiency of the engine, and it will reduce some carbon emissions from the engine. So it is called a mixture of hydrogen and methane, called as a HyTech. So we are generating from the biological reactors, it is called biohydrogen plus biomethane, is called as a biohydrogen. The suggested hydrogen content in the hydrogen is the 10 to 25% of by volume. Why we need to add the hydrogen to the methane? Because the heating value of hydrogen is 2-fold higher than the methane, and 7-fold increase in the burning speed compared to the methane, whereas the hydrogen has a 265 to 325 centimeter per second. By this, the efficiency of the engine will increase and mileage will increase. At the end, the carbon efficiency up to 10 to 25% we can reduce. So we converted the single stage bio system, the semi-pilot reactor we converted into single stage bio system, where we selected distillery wastewater as a feedstock for the production of biohydrogen from single stage. Till date, many researchers did production of biohydrogen with the dual bioreactor systems, where biohydrogen for one reactor for biohydrogen production and one reactor for biomethane production. We tried and we attempted to produce both the hydrogen and methane from a single stage bioreactor. We named it as a hybrid biosystem. So this is the where initially we allow for a hydrogen production. Later we produce hydrogen from the reactor. Later we allow bioreactor to produce methane. This is happened by using distillery spent wash as a feedstock, where we have readily available volatile fatty acid in the feed and pH and high COD content in the vessel. It helps to produce both hydrogen and methane from single reactor. This is the overall biohydrogen production. We operated with three different organic loading rates: lower organic loading rate, medium organic loading rate, and higher organic loading rate, where we achieved maximum of more than 14 liter per hour of biohydrogen from single bioreactor system. These are the individual profiles of biohydrogen and biomethane. If you see initially, it is more towards the biohydrogen and less towards the biomethane. Whereas at the optimum organic loading rate, it is hydrogen production is stabilized, whereas methane is gradually increased and stabilized after few cycles of operation. And at higher loading rate, as I said, the VFAs are very high and the pH of the substrate is very low. So it is not feasible for production of biohydrogen. This is the overall cumulative biohydrogen where we are able to produce more than 450 liters of biohydrogen from single stage reactor. One more beauty of the reactor is we can vary the composition. As I said, initially it is producing hydrogen and later it is towards the methane production. So we can vary the composition of the biohydrogen as we desired. So this is the composition analysis, which is the composition of hydrogen in overall biohydrogen. If we want to decide for a desired composition, we can regulate the production with respect to operating time. This is the overall composition profile. And this is why it is happening. We would like to know the why it is happening, how it is able to produce from a single reactor. Here, the composition of carboxylic acids like VFAs plays a very important role in the biohydrogen production from single stage bioreactor. So these are the three basic reactions we considered. And based on these equations, we calculated here both production of VFA is occurring by estrogenic pathway, and both simultaneously it is also being consumed by methanogenic pathway. So there is a simultaneous reaction between VFA production, VFA consumption. So we calculated both production and consumption. The upper profile represent the VFA production during hydrogen production pathway, and the lower profile depicts that the consumption by methanogenic pathway. This is for the total carboxylic acid, and this is for the acetic acid, and this is for butyric acid, and this is for propionic acid. So these are the overall profiles of both biohydrogen, biomethane, and COD removal efficiency. This is COD removal efficiency is also more or less similar, and substrate degradation rate is also same for organic loading 1 and 2. And here, these are pictures taken by me during my field visit to the industries. So in industries, some industries like paper and pulp, chemical industries are using aerobic treatment methods for treatment of the wastewater generated from their processes. But comparing to these waste, by these, I wanted to tell you that the COD organic loading rate from the industrial wastewater is more or less varying from 6 to 15 grams per liter of COD. It is not sufficient to operate biohydrogen production at a large scale, like 10 meter cube and 100 meter cube. We need a higher organic loaded organic wastewater. For this, in my opinion, there will be a one suggestion that we can add food waste from the restaurant, leftover food waste, which are rich in high organic content, and municipal solid waste, which are biodegradable municipal solid waste, which are rich in higher organic content. We can mix different kinds of wastewater and we can treat at a higher organic loading rate at higher volumes of the bioreactor. It will be very feasible and it will be very efficient for operation of the bioproduction processes. And for the MFC, there are a lot of sewage treatment units are being installed in all apartments and in all industrial area where domestic effluent is generating in a high amount of quantities. Where for MFC, even 1 gram per COD, one gram per liter of COD is good enough to operate. I think COD for MFC operation, starting from sewage to any kind of wastewater is good enough. If the cleaner wastewater means only we allow dissolved components to the fuel cell, we avoid the suspended solids and other material to the MFC, then MFC will operate it efficiently at a higher conversion efficiency, so more than 60% of Coulombic energy conversion efficiency. And one more point I wanted to tell you is regarding the plastics. Though it is not a part of my presentation, I wanted to make a note of it. So in the year, from the year 2016 onwards, government of India is banning all plastics in various places of India. Whereas in India, 2018 hosted the World Environment Day with the theme of Beat Plastic Pollution. As per the website, it is showing that 18,80,559 kg per day of plastic is being produced by India, and 85% is mismanaged. So in my opinion, bioplastic, more or less 60 to 70% is the single use plastic being wasted every day. So in my opinion, bioplastic production will be the best solution for this problem. And one more thing I wanted to tell you, Felice, if technology not giving you everything, then try tree plantation, which will give you worth of living. Because tree gives you a lot of things, like it will sequester the carbon and reduce emissions, provide fruits, wood, and it prevent flooding, and it will control the climate, and it will control the all natural erosion issues. So try to plant a tree. For the tree plantation, large areas are not required. Just for few fruit bearing plants and few vegetable plants in every house backyard or balcony is good enough. If every house will do that, then we achieve maximum usage of tree plantation, and we do something about the carbon sequestration. And ministry also is imposing lot of condition to the industries where carbon budgeting is must and should for every steel industries and thermal power plants, so that they will know how much carbon dioxide is emitting by their industry, and how much what are the measures to be taken to sequester released carbon. Even ministry also imposing that at least minimum 33% of the total project area to be developed by with the green belt. However, if you see the report of carbon budgeting and the amount of tree plantation they are doing, it not serving 10% of carbon sequestration also. So if some technologies like bioelectrochemical systems, my supervisor, Dr. Deepak Mann, will tell you elaborately at the today's end of session. So if that kind of technologies will come commercially in India, it will serve some portion of the problems. So once again, I thank you all of you, and I thank Sharda University and the MIT, especially Dr. Abhilasha Madam, Dr. Soumya Pandit, and Dr. Deepak Jadhav for giving me opportunity, and thank you so much. Over to the hosts.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for sharing such a wonderful, interesting, and informative talk. And we appreciate your presence with us.
Thank you.
So I'll take few questions, sir. Yeah. The one question is from Yash Dalji. As you said, sir, that for more amount of output, we have to do stacking. So which type of stacking specifically gives more output?
Stacking we have to do in a array formats. But I, in my doctoral studies, I tried to do that, but unfortunately I didn't. We have to do in a array formats. So, but how many columns, how many rows, I cannot tell you right now, because we have to do experiment on that conditions. So okay. We connect the series or parallel electric connections so that we can achieve the higher current output by connecting parallel circuit mode, and higher voltage output by series connecting mode. As per the required, we can connect accordingly.
Okay, fine. Another question is, sir, from Mr. Jitendra Prasad from MNIT Allahabad. How much long time MFC can provide power to electronic device like watch?
Here, for the time of operation, generally, as per my experience, it is taking about 7 to 10 days for stabilizing in open circuit condition, and after that it will take around 15 to 1 month for giving higher power generation, higher and stable power generation. But there is a limitation that for every 3 months, as per my experience, for every 3 months biofouling is occurred, means the layer initially formed on the first layer formed on the surface of the electrode, it is at the dead phase, and it is creating some resistance for the younger generations of the biofilms, transfer of electrons from biofilm to electrode. So every 3 months you need to flush your electrodes and restart again. So that is one issue
And sir, in continuation to his question, he has written, and which parameter is important for MFC electrical point of view, voltage or current or power density?
Parameter is the primary is the voltage. After that, you will connect the electric circuit with external resistance, and if you maintain the voltage, the electricity also will be maintained. Finally, it will result the power, higher power output.
Okay.
Because with respect to the electrode surface area, we cannot operate below the cell design point and above the cell design point. Both the values will give you lower efficiency, lower electric efficiency. You have to operate at the optimum at the cell design point itself, so that higher electric efficiency we can extract from the fuel cell.
And sir, another question is from Mr. Sagar Jariwala. How can we find internal resistance of MFC?
We can find the internal resistance of MFC by doing polarization studies, by varying by connecting fuel cell from higher resistance to lower resistance. We can graph according to the voltage and the power densities where we can achieve the higher power generation. That will be the cell design point, internal resistance. That will be the cell design point, and then that will lead to the that will indirectly give the internal resistance of the fuel cell.
Okay, and another question is from Dr. Prasan. What legal?
I'm sorry. Hello. Hello.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, right now.
The question is, what ligand is used to prepare the biofilm in EAB?
What medium?
What ligand? Ligand, sir. Have you used any ligand to prepare the biofilm?
No. We didn't use any such kind of thing. We did, whatever the biofilm formed is, we used mixed consortia as a feedstock. So whatever biofilm formed on the surface, we enriched with by connecting external resistance. We enriched the whatever formed on the electrode surface area. We enriched the same by connecting electrodes with the external resistance. We didn't do any additional things.
And sir, how the electrode properties affects the biofilm formation on anode electrodes? How the electrode properties affects the biofilm formation
electrode
on anode.
It should not be produce any captive currents. It should be good enough to form a biofilm, and it should be electrically conductive. There should be no other resistance between electric circuit and electrode. The electrode should be conductive towards the electricity, and there should not be any disturbance between the connections and the electrode. And moreover, for formation of electroactive bacteria, you need to close the circuit. Then only the electrode will be in pressure that electricity, the cathode need electrons from the anode. The cathode will give a stress to the bacteria, so that bacteria will continuously produce the electrons to the electrode, so that the bacteria will multiply itself and it will form a good biofilm on the electrode surface area. Thus electroactive bacteria will be enriched on the electrode surface area. And for good electrode like carbon cloth and graphite is also good electrode for the bioelectricity generation. And other electrodes like nowadays, many researchers are using pour nanoparticles on the electrode surfaces. They for enhancing the electrode surface. They are also using giving good results on MFC electricity output.
Sir, one last question I would like to take, sir. Which type of power management device is best for extracting power from MFC?
I'm so sorry, I cannot answer this question because I didn't use any power devices for the MFC operation.
Okay. No problem, sir. Okay, thank you so much, sir, for giving us your time, precious time, and giving us all this information. Thank you so much.
Thank you once again, Sharada University and MIT, for giving such a good opportunity to deliver in front of a huge number of audience. Thank you.
Pleasure, sir, pleasure. So now I'm very happy to announce that we have finished our morning session, pre-lunch session. And before going on the lunch break, I'd like to make you familiar with our eminent speakers of the post-lunch session. So we'll be having the talks from Dr. G.P. Nagori, Ankur Energy Technologies, And second talk from Dr. Dinesh K. Ramalingam. He's from CSIR, CSMCRI, Gujarat. And Dr. Deepak Pant, he's from VITO, Belgium. So hope to see my all active participants again on the same platform. Mm-hmm. You all can, I request you all to assemble. I request you all to assemble after lunch break at the same link.
At 15
p.m. IST. Sorry, there was some intervention.